And many times, because of God is so good, you know, we teach how gracious God is, full of compassion, slow to anger. So sometimes that gives people a license to continue in their what? Mess. He said, well, since God is so good, I'm just going to keep on sinning and just let his goodness keep flowing. Just see how good he can be. But the Bible says, shall we continue in sin, so grace, you know, so that more grace may abound. You know, we are not to continue sinning so we can get more grace, so we can experience more goodness, more mercy, more love. Amen. But we are to what? Amen. The scripture says, shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? And the scripture says, the answer is what? No. Amen. When you know the truth, God doesn't want you to just what stay in that condition and experience, just so that you can experience more mercy. He wants you to what? Turn, because there are some repercussions for what? Persistent in sin. There are some repercussions. Amen. Praise God. You know, it will be okay. Probably, you know, God is so good and tolerant, he'll go bear along with us a long time. But finally, somewhere down the line, when you least expect it, bam. And it's not really God cutting you down, really. It's what? It's the law on what? Retribution. That's right. It's the law working. Amen. But God, you know, people blame God for all of this, but really, God has placed in operation all different kinds of law. Amen. I just like, you know, I heard me tell the story of her mother had a baby. She was bathing her baby in her tub. She had him in there, and just a little baby, probably about the size of your kid, your hip kid. Make sure you don't make this mistake. And you just put him in the tub, and it was a heater, electric heater, over there where he could touch. So he reached over and touched the heater, and accidentally, that's killed him, right? Dead as a doodad. And then the mother, you know, she just went hysterical, and as a result, she ended up blaming God for that particular mishap. But it was a law. So that shows that God didn't really do that, right? Is that right? And the other illustration that I often give is that a mother had two twin girls, and these were beautiful little girls, and they both were sick, and they had gone to the doctor to get some medication, and on the kitchen cabinet, the medications were there, but also it was a bottle of poison, some kind of chemical that was poison. And when the mother at night, not turning her lights on, not knowing which was what, so she accidentally got the bottle that had poison, and then she ended up giving a dose of that poison. And of course, needless to say, both of those babies were dead. They buried both of them at the same time. The mother took it so hard until a few days that she succumbed as well. That wasn't God's fault. It just be what results of what? Of a law in operation, right? And so many times we think that, you know, God is just kind of looking over and just kind of watching everything we do. So you can what? Just bam. Just like the bam. Just waiting. I mean, just like a patrolman, you know, the battle recorder kind of hide out. Y'all know about those hide out patrolmen? How many of them got caught by a patrolman that you couldn't see? That's the worst feeling you could ever have. Boy, your stomach just sinking. Just sink down. Boy, it's awful. But actually, the things that we reap in life is not really God doing it as so much as a law that we violate, and that law is going to work whether we are saved or unsaved, right? Whether we're good or kind, whether we know about the law or whether we don't know about the law. Oh, hallelujah. So that's the reason why we want to try to do our best to get in line with God's spiritual laws. That's the motivation for living by the word and actually getting a door. See, we've been teaching that all of these mercies and all of these blessings, see, God is full of compassion and he yearns to pour these blessings out on us. I mean, God got a jillion blessings already laid up and provided for us. And the thing that is so exciting that he yearns to do this. He's not just willing, but he yearns. He's eagerly waiting and seeking the opportunity to release these blessings into our lives. But God just can't arbitrarily just say, well, brother, Bergeron. He's a nice guy. He got a nice wife. And I'm just going to just pull all of these blessings out on him. Just arbitrarily. Without him assuming any kind of what? Responsibility. See, God just can't do things just because he can do them. He has to have certain types. There are certain factors that he has to what? Work from. There are certain things that have to be in place before God can legally. See, God just, if God just could just walk up to anybody without requiring anything of them and just pull out everything he had on them, right? And then over here, Brother Pacheco, he needs a blessing just as bad as Brother Wayne. And he would withhold them from him, but he'll just put it on him. And maybe Brother Wayne, so we know he doesn't get like, maybe he's not living up to what the dog needs. And Brother Pacheco, he should have been trying to do the best, do all he knows to do. But see, God has to have a standard. He has to have a rule. He has to have some method to reward people that will what? That will receive, that will play by his rules, play by his program. So God has to have certain things in place, otherwise he would violate his moral laws. That's the reason why it's important for us to try to come into line with whatever condition, whatever God tells us to do, whatever position that we need to place ourselves in for God's blessings to reach us. That's the reason why we need to what? Try to position ourselves for God to bless us. Amen. All through the Bible, we can see God's compassion in existence all through the Bible. But there were some people that he passed by. Right? How many remember the man that was at the pool of Bethesda? He had been there for what? 39 years. Right? And it was a whole multitude of people. They were there waiting for the same results that the man that had been waiting for 38 years waited for. But when the day came, when the water was troubled, it was only one person that was able to get into the water. All the multitudes, amen, they didn't get no result because they didn't meet the condition. You had to what? Get in the water. And how did this man get in the water? He said, I don't got nobody to put me in. Amen. Praise God. Did he get in the water?
Did he get in?
All right, I'm
asking
good, y'all.
They said he had it. I have
a guess
too.
Okay, so I don't have nobody to put me in the water, right?
Well, I think, because somebody always, only one could get in.
Only one could get in.
And then most of that in before he could get there.
Right.
Because he was not able to ambulate to get in. So
right.
I don't think there's a record of him ever getting in.
All right, but
if
the man,
I can remember.
The man got healed, right?
Yes, he did.
But
right.
He didn't get in the water.
Okay, but the one that troubled the water, amen, was the one that was still in the water, right? So he just told him what? Get up and what? Amen. But everybody that got results, the point is, everybody that got results, they had to place themselves in a position for them to what? Get the results that they got. And if you don't place yourself in the position, although God's blessing, the Bible says his eyes might be what? Running? It might be his good pleasure to give you the kingdom, right? Amen. He might delight in mercy. Amen. He might be eagerly yearning to pull these things out on you. Amen. But all of these attributes of God that we can clearly see, that he yearns, but yet there is something that all of us got to do.
And what did he do in this
page?
The one that said, I don't have any.
All right, well, his attention was pointed to Jesus. Okay, now here's the thing is that for every battle, for every victory, that's one. Every battle that's fought, and every victory, there's one. There's a God side of it. And there's a what? Man was that. There's something that God does. And then there's something that what?
We have to do.
Amen. So that's the motivation that we have. We're trying to magnify Jesus real, real big. We want to really project his love, his concern, his willingness. Amen. How much he yearns to bless, how much he wants to help and reach out to us. But we also have to keep in mind that these blessings will what? Run over us and over to, I mean, they will what pass us over. Unless we place ourselves in a position where these blessings and God's mercy or God's grace can actually what? Reach us. Amen. We have to place ourselves in position. Amen. That's the reason why, you know, we shouldn't expect anything from God when we won't. We just sit around and twiddle our thumbs. We won't, you know, how to open our mouths. You don't become broken. If we don't become broken, open up. Amen. This morning, typical example. Amen. People were just crying out to God. Lifting your voice. That's what God says to do. Amen. Because many times you can't place yourself in a position, amen, to receive these rich blessings that God has unless you actually get out of your flesh. See, your flesh is the thing that keeps many times people from getting in a position where God can help them. Because many times people say, well, it don't take all of that. I'm just going to sit here and just be quiet as I can be. And the Bible says that, shout for joy, O ye lands, fear not. Amen. Shout and be glad, and the Lord will do great things. Amen. The Bible says, let not the oppressed return ashamed. Let the poor and needy. How many poor? Nobody poor? Not even poor in spirit. Let the poor and needy do what? Praise the name. Amen. If we understood, amen, the level of praise God was looking for, amen, I believe that it would really be a great revelation for us to understand. Amen. God wants all of you. Everybody just said, God wants all of me. And that's something that most of us are a little reluctant to what? To give him. Amen. Give him everything until you don't have any more. Give him everything until what? You, amen, release it all. Amen. Praise him until you can't praise him anymore. Amen. Praise him until it gets kind of difficult. How many women know how it is when you're trying to release a baby? The Bible says when Zion travail, then she'll bring forth. I don't know how that feels, but I know how it feels when you are crying out and you're trying to get everything you can. I mean, it seems like down in your stomach, you feel your bowels constrict. Some of y'all looking at me saying, what is he talking about? I mean, on the inside, you just feel, you're down on the inside, you just feel something just straining. So I imagine when women are trying to release that baby, I believe that they are just trying to push and move, they're just trying to get it out, and it takes just about every ounce of energy. I imagine. With the shortest, that takes all your energy.
So that's
the way. But I don't think that we're aware that it takes a lot of releasing and to get out of flesh. Because when you really get out of flesh, then something is released in you,
And most times, the brokenness will really begin to what? Amen. Really begin to impact your spirit. Everybody said brokenness.
Brokenness.
Brokenness is when you release all you have, and as a result, you just, amen, sometimes you begin to, you cry, you weep, you're broken, and that good feeling begins to what? Grip your insides. Amen. So in the morning time, this is when I guess it's easy. I guess it's kind of hard, brothers and sisters, isn't it? After you working and messing around and who was that guy from Cairns horsing around with the boys?
Oh, Lord, that's
Don't bring him. Don't let him fly. Let him fly. Leave him alone. All right. Leave him alone. All right. But this is the direction that we are going this week, because we really want you to understand that it's important for us to place ourselves in a position for God to really bless us. And the way I do it personally, I just, I stir myself up to seek the Lord. That's what I do. I stir myself up. And I know in order to stir myself up, I have to let words come out of my mouth that's in agreement with what God wants to do for me or what God is doing for me. I let words come out of my mouth that's in agreement with what God is doing for me, or what God wills to do, or what God yearns to do for me. Amen. Praise God. You know, things like the scriptures that I've been giving you, and he delighteth in mercy. Lord, your eyes are running to and fro. You're searching us all out. You're seeking for perfect hearts. Amen. Praise God. And words like this morning, you know, I just let these things, I read them and meditate them. And when I start praying, I just pray arbitrarily. I just let whatever comes out, comes out. Whatever God's quickened me to say, that's what I say. And I put everything I have in it until I begin to weep or cry. I release all that I have. And when I release all that I have, usually I'll break. And that's the thing that will move other people that's around you. See, many times people feel that I don't have to come to prayer to really get what I need from God. But I think it's very selfish for people that just says, well, I can do all my praying at home. I think that's very selfish, because very few people you're gonna help just by praying alone at home all the time. Now, suppose every morning I have y'all out here praying, Sister Benny, and I'm at home. I ain't gonna be that much help to you. Y'all gonna be on your own. And I think that we ought to try to what? Come prepared to what? To help and to give to somebody else. Just don't sit in your little corner and say, I'm just taking all I can in myself. I'm just gonna hang in here, see how much I can get. And I think that you ought to have a mind to what? To let go and amen. David said, my cup what? Running over. And when your cup run over, when you get real happy, when you get real glad yourself, it's going to spill out on somebody else. Don't you want somebody else blessed?
Amen.
All right, so this is what we're doing this week. I mean, we're having such a good time. Just getting started. I think we'll put y'all on a fast tomorrow. It's not too quick. give you some time. Well, y'all had it. Well, how was the last time we called one? How much time do y'all need? We've given you several weeks. All right. But all of these good things, I'm going to get back to that judgment thing in a few minutes, but all of the good things that we have admonished you to say, we want you to begin to say them. And the prayer that we're using, page 31, 32.
Are we going to do Ecclesiastes 8 and 11?
Ecclesiastes 8 and 11. We're going to do that. Okay. Okay, let's do that. Let's do Ecclesiastes 8 and 11. Who has that? Okay, read it, please, for me.
Because sentence against an evil work is not executed speedily. Therefore, the heart of the sons of men is fully set in them to do evil.
Okay. See, that's the reason why many times people will continue to do evil, because a sentence against evil is not always very seldom God will execute that what? Speedily. And the reason why God doesn't execute sentence against an evil speedily is because God is a God of what? Mercy.
Yes.
So he's, the Bible says he's full of what? Compassion. Slow to what?
Anger.
And of what?
Great
mercy. That's the reason why he doesn't execute it speedily. So he persists, amen, with you. I mean, he persists with you in your sin. He just kind of go along. It doesn't mean that you're going to be getting by easy or nothing bad will be happening to him. But in terms of God lowering the axe on you and really bringing a big judgment on you, more than likely it's not going to happen immediately. Because God wants you to, the Bible says, the goodness of the Lord is designed to lead us to what? Repentance. That's the thing that God uses to bring us to repentance, is what? Goodness. Okay, let me just show you that scripture. That's a good scripture that you need to hold on to. Now, judgment is an attribute of God. He is a God of judgment, but God is mostly a God of what? Love, right? He's primarily a God of what? Love. The greatest attribute of God would be what? He's a God of love. Is that right? Now, judgment is an attribute, but the Bible says to God, judgment is a strange act. In other words, it's something that God, what? Doesn't want to do. Y'all understand what I'm saying? It's something that God, what? He doesn't want to do it. Okay, let me... I think it's Isaiah 28:21, by judgment is a strange act. This was talking about God's judgment, but God was saying it's a strange act. But it's something that God will do as the last resort when we refuse to respond to his goodness. When we refuse to respond to his mercy. Is that right, Isaiah 28:21? Okay, so both of those scriptures kind of go together, Isaiah 28:21, and the one Sister Hill read, the Ecclesiastes, what was that?
8 and 11.
Okay, that's kind of put the judgment side of God into perspective with his love side. He's basically a God of love, right? But he's also a God of judgment, but judgment is something that what? He doesn't want to do. He'll do everything under the sun, amen, try to what? Get you to respond to his what? Mercy. He'll do everything he can. And the scripture you want to write down now would be in Romans.
That was
Isaiah 28:21. And the next one would be 28:21. And the other one was Romans. Romans 2, start with verse 1. Therefore thou art inexcusable, O man, whosoever thou art that judgest. For wherein thou judgest another, thou condemnest thyself. For thou that judgest doest the same thing. You have people that always criticize and condemn and judge other people. And they are what? Actually doing what? Doing the same thing or doing something worse. Okay? But we are sure that the judgment of God is according to truth against them which commit such things. And thinkest thou this, O man, that judgest them which do such things, and doest the same, that thou shalt escape the judgment of God? See, there's a judgment side of God. We have to keep that in mind. There's a judgment side of God. Amen. And there's a so long, the Bible says that, let me see, how does that go? Can't remember exactly what I think of it in a minute, but God will let us persist in sin. I mean, he'll let it, and sometimes people do it for a long time. And people misconstrue the goodness of God, and they use the goodness of God because God doesn't what? Punish them for sins that they're doing. And they say what? Well, it seems like this is working out pretty good for me. I think I just go a little further. Ain't nothing happened all this time. Right.
What was that, sister? The name?
He does that awful reproof. All right, that's good. He does that awful reproof, and hard his neck shall suddenly be destroyed, and death without remedy. Proverbs 29:1. All right.
I tell you another good passage of scripture. It's too long to read.
Okay, okay, wait a minute.
That's Psalm 73.
Okay, well let's try to take care of this before we.
No, we don't need to read that.
Okay. Okay. Here we go. Here. And thinkest thou this, O man, that thou should that judgest them which do such things and doest the same, that thou shalt escape the judgment of God? Or despisest thou the riches of His goodness? And forbearance and long suffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. See, the goodness of God, the mercies of God, the love of God, and God just putting up with you, tolerating with you, and just, you know you ain't right. You know you are not living up to God's standards and things that God has clearly delineated that we should live up to. And if you persist in that, then it seems like sometimes God is just completely silent. It seems like everything is what? Fine. But Sister Denise just said, he that is often reproved and hardens his neck shall what? Suddenly be destroyed. Most times, right in the midst of your mess, when you least think that judgment will strike, amen, that law of retribution is going to what? Catch up with you. The axe is going to what? Fall. So that's the reason why we don't need to play with God. What worries him? Well, he got under the table. okay, he said something. Okay, but that is the reason why you want to really scrutinize your life. You don't want no hidden agendas. You want to get everything out, right? You want to make sure that you're lining up with God the best you know. So the Bible says, he that knoweth to do good and don't do it to him is what?
Sin.
And there's a lot of things, a lot of adjustments we need to make. Amen. And many times, God will just let you keep doing stuff for a long time. And you don't have no idea because the hatchet hasn't fallen. You have no idea that all of this is about what? God's goodness is just trying to lead you what? To get straight. Before you die in sin and lose your what? Soul throughout eternity. That's what he's trying to do. And God puts up with people a long time sometimes. And then sometimes others are not as fortunate. Amen. It just depends on the circumstances. Amen. Because there's a law at work. And these laws work without what? Respect to a person. Right? Even if you don't know the law is working, it still won't exempt you from the consequences of that law. Amen. So we just want to understand that, you know, I just really believe that the coming of the Lord is real close, really close. The reason I say that, you know, I'm going to get back on my end time teaching probably the first of the year. And I'm trying to perfect it because the first time y'all didn't get it. I guess I did a poor job or just something. Y'all didn't get it, but I'm going to start out with probably the seven signs, the seven major signs. And I guarantee you, even the last sign that will precede the coming of the Lord for us will be a nation that will rise up, that will defy Israel and threaten Israel's existence. And threaten to, amen, destroy them and wipe them out of existence. I'll let you determine whether that nation is already in place. All right. Now suppose, now who knows what Iran got? Who knows Israel is threatening to what? Launch an attack against them right now. If Israel launch an attack, guess who's going back to Iran and Iraq? Who's going back? America's going back. And we know that's going to trigger, amen, the war of Armageddon. Amen. We're just so close. We're just hanging on by the thread of a sewing thread. We're just hanging on. And saying, we're, you know, if we're going to still play games, and Jesus is close, and you feel like, you know, you're still going to just take it or leave it, or just kind of do it the way you want to do it, amen, somebody's not going to be ready when Jesus comes. So it's only my job is to lay it out, lay it out. If I miss it, if I don't get it over the first hand, try to what? Amen, revamp, restructure, break it down, put it in another form, whatever it takes. I want to get it over this time, because our time, amen, praise God, is very, very short. We need to take even the prayer meetings serious, because these prayer meetings are designed to place you in a position where you can get the grace you need, the mercy you need, the help you need, the strength you need, whatever you need in order to be prepared when Jesus comes. It's not something that you can just do at the drop of a hat. Amen. Some of us got some issues that we need to work through.
Yes.
Amen. Is that right?
Yeah.
Amen. If Christ is coming back for a church that has been washed by the washing of the Word, amen. When we hear the Word, we're going to have to let the Word what? Amen. We're going to have to give place. Give heed to it. We're going to have to really do it, because we are cleansed by the what? Word. When we hear it, then we begin to what? Apply that word to our lives and get ourselves in what? Line with that word. Amen. Then we can be ready when Jesus comes. Okay, now let's look at that again. I'm just about done with that. And it says Romans 3. But after the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. But after thy hardness and impenitent heart. See, this
Romans
is when.
Romans 3
5. See, the goodness of the Lord is designed to lead us to repentance. 2:5. Okay, 2:5. Okay. It's designed to lead us to what? Repentance. To get our lives what? Right. To get ourselves what? Straight. And getting up in the morning, praising God, having these deep prayers, broken prayers, and making the sacrifice. These are the things that will get at the root of your what? Your flesh, your problem. They get at the root of it. Amen. I mean, I don't know how many people have told me that. Like Brother Travis always said, he said that all the challenges that I had when I first got saved, he admits that he had several challenges. He said it was the morning prayer. It was the word. It was the